How's everyone doing today on reInvent Day 2? We good? All right. We got our coffee going? Perfect. So, yep. Of course, we are going to talk about reducing context switching through DevOps use cases. We're going to talk about first, you know, if you think you know Slack, if you use Slack, we're going to talk about how to think about how to continue to use it and how to get more value out of it. And then, of course, we're going to get into all the integrations with AWS and a lot of the use cases and a lot of the value that our customers see and how you can really make the most of it as well. So first, I want to talk about the chaos and complexity of modern-day DevOps and what's been happening over the last 5 to 10 years, what's gotten better, but also what's gotten more more difficult as well. So software development, it's gone through several massive transformations over the last 5 to 10 years, right? We're launching faster, more often than ever, in smaller increments with higher quality. And Agile and DevOps are these two things that have changed not only the way that we build and deliver and fix code, but also more fundamentally how we work together in teams. And it's really stretched the difference from elite engineering teams and laggard engineering teams. This new way of working, it's obviously better, right? It produces better business results. I don't think we're here to refute that. But what we've also seen is it's introduced silos and complexity and tool overload into the way that we're working across our teams. And first, we're working more cross-function than ever. And really, these productized organizations, which is great, we're working agilely, but we've actually seen this introduce silos across the across and within the engineering org itself. Second is microservices and API-driven architectures. They have teams spread across more things. There's more breadth to work across. And coordination is becoming more difficult. And so engineering teams are more dependent than ever before on internal services, external services, and vendors than ever before. And this is only continuing to increase. And finally, there's been a best-of-breed explosion of tools, of dev tools, of ops tools, where every team can adopt exactly what works for them and what fits for them. But there's really nothing that kind of brings these tools all together. And so even though our team structures and our tools have evolved to support Agile and DevOps, communication and collaboration are two things that haven't quite caught up in the same way. So if you're releasing software every 2 weeks or weekly or even on a daily basis, this chain of command style that maybe we've been used to in the past, it just doesn't work. And I think the key here is that if you're communicating via email or even just simple chat, what you're essentially trying to do is agile development, but with waterfall communications. And you can start to see the mismatch here, and I'll walk through this. And we see that this creates silos across email threads and one-to-one direct chat and tribal knowledge that's trapped in different teams, that's trapped in different tools. And it just doesn't reflect the way that we need to work in agile teams and DevOps cultures. And it creates confusion and last-minute scrambling. So imagine a game of telephone, but every single day with millions of dollars at stake. What we really need is a way to centralize all this collaboration and really bring transparency to it all. And we'll show this as well. And so we know Agile and DevOps have transformed software development, but it's also created some new requirements in order to make it successful. And now when we talk about, you know, how does Slack fit in this picture, I think there's a really easy analogy of how to think about it. And so we're all familiar with Google, right? You can think of Google as the window into all the knowledge and all the information across the world, where Slack is really that same window, but to all the knowledge and all the work across your entire organization and across teams. Slack is really this window that brings together your teams and your tools and all your communications into a single pane of glass. It unlocks your ability to collaborate across teams more easily, reduce your DevOps cycles, communicate with more transparency, and really integrate your tool set, whether it's dev, whether it's monitoring, whether it's general collaboration, and really bring this all together. And while we can admit and say that Slack is not necessarily an agile tool, Slack is not necessarily a DevOps tool, let's be honest, but what it does do is it reflects the way that your teams work in agile teams, and it reflects the way that your teams work in DevOps cultures, and makes this a lot easier. And so, well, how do we categorize Slack then? We call Slack your digital HQ for engineering. And first, that it breaks down silos through channels that no matter where you are in the org chart, you have that transparency and that visibility, and you're involved no matter where you are in that, again, on that org chart. And Slack Connect extends this cross-functional collaboration to external parties. So think of vendors, third-party developers, even customers, and in a secure space where you can work together. Second is all about embracing flexibility, because we know engineering teams are not just distributed across time zones, but also across preferred working styles. And so features like huddles and clips in Slack, they help bring back the informality that we had in the physical headquarters, and it brings that informality back into the digital space, which lets everyone communicate how they want and when they want, which obviously increases engagement. And teams can also work asynchronously, and Slack helps you reduce the number of meetings that you have and be more effective working asynchronously, and letting people know when it's heads down focus time with features like do not disturb mode and customizing your notifications. And that's really the equivalent of back in the office where you put on headphones to let people know, don't disturb me, I'm heads down, I'm writing code, I'm building something. And finally, Slack helps you automate work. So with over 2,400 out-of-the-box app integrations in Slack, with all your dev and ops tools, think of Jira, think of Bitbucket and GitHub and Jenkins and PagerDuty and Datadog and, of course, AWS, which is why we're here, and really integrating all these tools together to automate many of your engineering processes. And with building blocks on Slack platform and workflows, you can really start to custom tailor these automations to really make it work and fit your specific tool set, even with DIY and homegrown tools. So Slack is this digital HQ that helps you ship quality code faster, it helps you minimize incidents and downtime through incident management, and really improve the developer experience. This is what we hear all the time, is improving that dev experience and the productivity and the culture, and really kind of more fundamentally transforming the way that your teams build and deliver and fix software. Now, it's difficult to imagine all the different ways that these cross-functional engineering teams can work across Slack. So I'm just going to flash up the software development lifecycle here and give a couple examples of how this works. So first, as we're planning a feature, integrating something like Jira, so you can do product planning, feature planning, sprint planning, and even asynchronous stand-ups in Slack, again, to reduce the number of meetings and increase that transparency. Next, when you're ready to start build something, we see this all the time with like GitLab and GitHub and Bitbucket, doing pull requests and code reviews directly in Slack, and the whole team having visibility to that. Then, when you're ready to start pushing that code through CI/CD, doing things like vulnerability scanning with JFrog and with Sneak, and actually really in seeing the transparency as that's getting pushed through the pipeline. Seeing when builds are successful, seeing when tests are failed, and immediately in the whole team having that visibility to what's going on in the pipeline. Then when you're ready to deploy, everyone can follow along with those deployments. You have a time-stamped audit trail of exactly what got deployed and when. And then if something does go wrong, which inevitably it will, you can very quickly spin up a dedicated incident channel, auto-invite all your on-call responders into that channel, and really start to streamline the troubleshooting and investigations of incident management, and bring in your monitoring and observability tools to show exactly what's going on and all that system's behavior, again, in a single place. So now let's get into AWS, and this is really exciting, is we integrate with over 200 AWS services that are fully featured. And a big question we get is, well, which AWS services? I'm not going to list all 200, but there's a lot of them, and they span across dev and operations and AWS admin and incidents and security. And so for developers, you can get events piped in through Event Bridge, or you get notifications piped in through your CI/CD services through AWS. For operators, you can manage environments, you can get updates on the health with something like CloudFormation or AWS Health. For admins, you can track your budget quotas, make sure you're not spending too much with billing and cost management, or even get compliance notifications with AWS config. And when something does go wrong, of course, you bring in CloudWatch, you bring in GuardDuty that alert you to exactly what's happening so you can quickly take action on it. In AWS chatbot, it's not actually that complicated. AWS services simply use this one AWS chatbot as this bi-directional conduit to send notifications and actionable alerts into Slack. Then, using Slack as that engagement layer, you can actually take action on these alerts and make changes back into AWS with things like buttons, with workflows, and have this, again, be in a single pane of glass. You can set up which notifications are sent to which channels and which services through the AWS console. But a big question here is, well, when do I use AWS chatbot versus when do I actually go into the AWS console? And a really easy way to think about this is the idea of thin versus thick work. And I'll explain this. So thin work are very simple and repeatable things like notifications. A notification, something gets piped in, that's thin work. That's very simple, right? We think that all notifications should come into Slack because, again, you get this visibility, you get this transparency, everyone sees what's going on. But in terms of taking action from Slack, some of this can actually be thin work as well. And we recommend that actions that you take from Slack are simple and repeatable. So if you're building a new environment from scratch, this is more the example of thick work. And obviously, this is what you go into the AWS console to go do. But if you're spinning up or spinning down an environment, a dev environment that you use all the time, we actually see that as thin work, and you can do that directly from Slack. So going to run through a couple of examples here of what this actually looks like in Slack and some of the use cases that we see our customers using all the time with AWS chatbot. The first is just automating as many engineering processes as you can with our out-of-the-box tool integrations like AWS chatbot, but also all the other dev and ops tools that you use, using workflows or even lightweight custom apps so you can reach into these other homegrown tools and DIY tools that we may not have integrations for. One of the most simple automations is simply starting, stopping, or checking the status of an environment. This makes it really easy to reduce that context switching, so you don't have to go into the AWS console every single time to do this very simple task. We also recommend you bring in as many tools as possible across your sprint planning, CI/CD, source control, even your design tools, observability and monitoring, incident management, and bring as many tools as you possibly can into Slack so that you have these notifications and these approvals and even taking action where everyone, again, has this visibility to what's happening in that pipeline, to what's happening with that incident. AWS Code Pipeline is a great example of this, where you see all the CI/CD notifications come into Slack, and the whole team is able to see that. Next up is getting a little bit more into incident management. This is one of our top use cases that we see customers using and really getting tangible ROI from, is bringing in your monitoring tools and piping in those alerts directly into Slack channels. And so those same thresholds in AWS CloudWatch or whatever monitoring tools you might use, those alerts get piped in the Slack channels instead of someone's email inbox. And so whether it's an all productions incident channel that you're in or even a specific application, all your responders and all your stakeholders have visibility to what's happening. And you can quickly discuss and escalate that incident if you need and really have the appropriate response. All while eliminating the interruptions and distractions that happen when 60 people pile into a Zoom room. Next is just basically staying on top of cloud spend. Very, very simple use case, but also very valuable, is getting your budgets and quotas piped into Slack. So if someone goes out of office, other people can action on that. So again, you're not spending more than you need to, and everyone's staying on top of that cloud spend, which now we know is everyone's paying a little more attention to this. And finally, observability is getting your logs, getting your metrics, getting everything piped into Slack from all the different observability tools you use, whether that's a vendor, whether that's open source, and making all that really, really easy. And finally, you know, try this out. Go to our Slack app store and try to integrate the AWS chatbot. Start with maybe one service, a couple services. We have over 200 fully featured services. But try integrating that today and see what kind of value you get out of it, and really do this more incrementally so your teams can get used to all the automation that you're going to start to introduce here. And I want to thank you for your time. And if anyone has any questions, I'll be over here. We'll be at the Salesforce Content Hub this whole week as well. We can go into excruciating detail on everything we just showed here. So feel free to give us a visit. Thank you.